بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم بارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My brothers, my sisters in Islam, welcome to our I believe our third day of the tafsir of Surah Kahf, Alhamdulillah, in the series of Ramadan lessons on the stories of the Quran. Today, Alhamdulillah, we have a little bit of an introduction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do to this topic of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by being worried about our deeds that we will have on the Day of Judgment, and also about the fact that Shaitan didn't listen to Allah Azza wa Jalla and disobeyed him, because which now he will be in Jahannam forever. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will slowly move into the story of Musa alayhi salam and Khidr. And this is a story which has a lot of benefit, yeah, because the most important thing about any human being is for them to realize that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them a particular skill or given them a particular ability, that this may actually, to maximize that ability, may sometimes actually cause arrogance and pride to come into the heart. And in order for that not to happen, Allah Azza wa Jalla has always, above everyone, has given someone else a different type of ability or higher form of the same ability. So it may be that you're very knowledgeable about something, but you know what? There may be someone else that is more knowledgeable about you or has more knowledge than you about a particular point of an issue. So this is in order to humble us. This is in order to have the people of knowledge always remember that above them there will always be someone else. And it is what Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah had said, that I've never grown in knowledge except that I've realized how little I know and how there is always someone above me that knows more than me. So Ikhwani, my brothers, my sisters in Islam, this is a story of Musa and Khidr, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will teach us a lesson through their story, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will humble his prophet of God. And in it is a lesson that if we humble ourselves for Allah Azza wa Jalla, Allah elevates us. He who humbles himself for Allah, Allah Azza wa Jalla elevates him. طيب, let's take where we stopped off yesterday. We stopped off at I believe verse 45 from Surah Kahf. So let's restart at verse 46 inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajim. Al-mal wal-banun. Al-mal, which is wealth, wal-banun, which is the plural form of children. Banin, of Ibn, which is children, offsprings, zinatul hayati dunya. They are the attractions of the life of this dunya. Wal baqiyatu salihat, and I'm going to explain this word in just a bit. Wal baqiyatu salihat khayrun inda rabbik, khayrun, meaning it's better, inda with rabbik, with your Lord, thawaban, reward, in form of reward, it's better, wa khayrun amala, and is a better offering for Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب, المال والبنون, wealth and children, إخواني, are a distraction for us. There's no doubt about it. Wealth for obvious reasons, because it opens up so many doors to haram, and because it might make us proud and haughty, and might make us remember Allah less and depend more on the wealth than on Allah Azza wa Jal. Removes tawakkul, removes sabr, you know, all of those problems that wealth creates. But at the same time, banun as well, children can also cause that. Why? Because sometimes being overtly focused on making children happy, or in playing with the children, or in wasting time beyond an amount of time which is important to give to children, there can be a lot of waste of time. Not understanding what is good for children, that is also a waste of time. So we think something is good for children. Yeah, I got to put them in, good academic grammar schools, and so that they can get the best results. But then you've overlooked their Islamic education, or you know, you're so worried about your children learning how to speak your language properly that you forget about Arabic, or that you are so worried about them learning how to swim and how to have a camping in the school that you forget about creating good friendship circle for them. So many things we forget about our children. Also, we become overly protective over our children, so much so that we amass our wealth thinking that, I've got seven kids, I need seven homes for them, and I need seven cars for them. So you know, seven homes, you know, you focus on trying to make enough money for the seven homes and seven cars. So Ikhwani, this can become a distraction, because the more wealth you give children, the more dependent they become and the less they appreciate. And the more wealth you give the children, the more you make them incapacitated, the more dependent you make them. And the best thing you can give them is really education. But today, unfortunately, parents don't understand that, and they say, no, I've got to leave wealth behind for my kids and whatever else. And so this can become a zina, can become an attraction, can become a distraction away from Allah Azza wa Jal in the life of this dunya. Elsewhere, Allah Azza wa Jal has actually called, إِنَّ أَمْوَالُكُمْ أَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. Verily, your wealth and your children is a fitna for you. So no doubt it's a fitna and a test for us. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. And what is a baqiyatu الصَّالِحَاتِ? So baqiyat meaning that which remains, a salihat meaning that which is righteous. So those deeds that remain which are righteous are more beloved to Allah Azza wa Jal as a reward and better as an offering to Allah. So what is baqiyat al-salihat? The scholars of the past, the pious predecessors, have given us two opinions. Number one is the opinion that says it is subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. It is these five statements, yeah, which is dhikr, essentially dhikr, or the best of dhikr, which is subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. So these are the five statements which are from Baqiyat al-Salihat, and there are numerous hadith about this as well. And this is the opinion of the majority of the scholars. The second opinion, which does not go against this opinion but completes it, is the opinion that says Al-Baqiyat al-Salihat is your five daily prayers. Five daily prayers. And this is the opinion of Umar, Ibn Abbas, and a few other Sahaba as well, alhamdulillah. So many of the scholars of Islam, such as Ash-Shanqiti rahimahullah, Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, in his book Al-Adwa al-Bayan, the tafsir of Quran bil-Quran, he said Al-Baqiyat al-Salihat, when you put these two opinions together, you find that these opinions are not going against each other, because what is salah except dhikr? And what are these words of La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, except dhikr? So essentially, Baqiyat al-Salihat is dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal. And Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti states that al-Baqiyat al-Salihat is any righteous deed, is any righteous deed which Allah Azza wa Jal loves. This is called Baqiyat. Why? Because it remains. Whereas our wealth finishes, and it's Salihat because it's righteous done for Allah Azza wa Jal. Whereas wealth, you can do it for other than Allah Azza wa Jal, for yourself and for other things as well. So Ikhwani, your wealth and your children are a distraction, whereas the baqiyat al-salihat, dhikr of Allah, remembrance of Allah, gaining knowledge, talab al-ilm, your five daily prayers, your dhikr of Allah, then this is better with Allah Azza wa Jal. Meaning, if you can limit your need for wealth and the time you spend on the wealth in order to use it for this dunya, to a small amount of time, then spend the rest of your time for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that is what is beloved to Allah. So I myself, for example, I'm a medical doctor. I spend only about 2 or 3 months in a year working. Rest of the 10 to 9 months in a year, I spend in my da'wah work. Because this is what is important. If I can make my wealth and my money in those 2 or 3 months, and of course, you know, 2 or 3 months, you do get enough, a lot of money, but it's maybe sometimes difficult to run the whole year on just 2 or 3 months income. But if you can decrease your needs so much so that you can survive on 2 or 3 months income, then alhamdulillah, you've done quite well. And that is exactly the goal of people who read these verses. That when they read these verses, they should try to restrict their wealth and their income producing time to only 15 to 20, 30% of their time. The rest of the 60, 70, 80% of the time, spend it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal in your baqiyat al-salihat, personal ibadah, and in da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَوْمَ نُسَيِّرُ الْجِبَالِ. And on that day when we will cause the mountains to sayyir, sayyir means to move, meaning it will be uprooted and moving in the air, so much so they will be crushing, smashing each other. And on that day when the mountains will be uprooted and moving in the air, وَتَرَى الْأَرْضَ بَارِزَةً. And you will see the earth will have exposed itself, all the nakedness of the earth, meaning all the sins and whatever filthy deeds people have done on the earth will be laid bare for people to see. وَحَشَرْنَاهُمْ. And we have resurrected who? Resurrected all the people, back onto this earth. فَلَمْ نُغَادِرْ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدًا. We have not left a single soul or single being in the belly of the earth. We have caused them all to be resurrected. وَعُرِضُوا عَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ. And they have been put forward, meaning they have been presented, عَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ, to their Lord, صَفَّى. They have been presented to their Lord in ranks, in rows. لَقَدْ جِئْتُمُونَ, Allah says, verily you have come back to us. كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ, as we have created you, أَوَّلَ مَرَّةِ, the very first time. How did Allah create us the very first time? We were naked, we didn't have any shoes, no clothes, we were uncircumcised, we were barefooted, and this is what the Prophet ﷺ said, that on the day of judgment, يُحْشَرُ النَّاسِ, the mankind will be raised up, right? حُفَاتًا عُرَاتًا غُرْلًا. We will be raised up hufat, meaning no shoes. Urat, meaning naked. Ghurla, meaning uncircumcised. So these are the three ways that we will all be raised up, ikhwani. Exactly as Allah created us. لَقَدْ جِئْتُمُونَ كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ. You have come back to us as we have created you the very first time. Subhanallah. بَلْ زَعَمْتُمْ أَلَّن نَجْعَلَ لَكُمْ مَوْعِدًا. Rather, you thought and you had the audacity to even think that Allah Azza wa Jal will not put a appointed time for the meeting between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بَلْ زَعَنْتُمْ أَلَّن نَجْعَلَ لَكُمْ مَوْعِدًا. You thought we would not have an appointed time. Ikhwani, this is very serious. Allah Azza wa Jal will bring us back. And subhanallah, we will be brought back to this dunya, to this resurrection as Allah had created us. And this verse sends shivers down people's spines. To anyone reading it, because it shows that we will all be presented to Allah Azza wa Jal on that appointed day, and we cannot escape from it, ikhwani. There's no escape. Now that we have been created as human beings, there is no way our life will end. It will either be eternal Jannah or eternal Jahannam. There's simply no other way. And if that is the case, ikhwani, we have no choice but to run away from Allah to Allah. طيب, ووضع الكتاب. Another one more thing that will be put out, and that is the book of deeds that has been collected throughout all our time. ووضع الكتاب, and the book has been laid bare. فطر المجرمين, so you will see the wrongdoers, those who have committed jurm, those who have committed wrong on that day. مشفقين مما فيه, being so afraid to look. You know, look at your book, it'll be said, no, I don't want to really look that now. Should I even look, you know, mushfiqeen, yani because they know what they have done, right? So they're very afraid. Mushfiqeen amimma fi. But finally they muster the courage to have a look. So they say, ويقول, and they say, يقولون, they will end up saying, يا ويلتنا, oh woe to me, woe to me, يا ويلتنا. And the scholar said, wail means two things. It can either mean woe to me, or it can also mean wail, which is a valley in Jahannam which has been made for the mujrimeen. Yeah, it's the name of a valley in Jahannam. So whichever waylatana means, so oh waylatana, oh woe to me, ma li hadha al-kitab, what's wrong with this book? And they'll be like, what's wrong with this book? Huh? What's wrong with this book? What's wrong with this book? Like, what's wrong with this book? Yeah, what's wrong with this book? La yughadiru saghiratan, there's not a small thing I've done. Wala kabiratan, not a big thing I have done. إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا, except that it is in the book. So Allah says, وَوَجَدُوا مَا عَمِلُوا حَاضِرًا, and they will find what they have done, عَمِلُوا, what they have done, حَاضِرًا, meaning present in the book. وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا, and Allah will never ever do dhulm with anybody. My brothers, my sisters in Islam, these people, or us even, every single person, we will find this book complete with all of the stuff that we have done in it. In fact, it was reported that when Imam Ahmed was passing away, rahimahullah, and he was making some sounds from the pain that he was in, his son, Abdullah, came in and said, Oh my father, don't even make those sounds. For indeed, even that is being written down. So, ikhwani, everything has been written down. I mean, the Prophet, you know, when I read the verse, Abasa wa tawalla, he turned around and frowned. Frowned. He didn't make a sound. He just frowned with his mouth. You know, he made a grimacing sound face. That's it. Even that was written down. Ya ikhwani, there's nothing except that is written down, except what is in your heart that you don't act upon. But if you make a grimace, you make an expression, you communicate, you voice, you say something, all of this is written down. So it's very, 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 very important, brothers and sisters, that we're very careful of our deeds that we do on this earth, because there's nothing except that's written down. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, "Though whoever believes in Allah in the last day, let him be quiet. Let him be quiet and speak nothing but the truth. Let him speak good or keep shut or be completely quiet. Because whatever we do, ikhwani, is written down and will be presented to us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and have mercy on us. Now this book is the book that is compiled by the angels from our deeds that is taken up by the angels on Mondays and Thursdays. So the books, the deeds are not taken up every day. The angels go back and tell Allah what they did, but the book of deeds is actually on the Asr time and Fajr time is simply transferred. So it's like I'm writing on this book, group of angels come, here you go, take over the book and continue writing. So they continue writing. On the Monday and the Thursday, the book of deeds is taken up. Then when the book of deeds is taken up, Allah Azza wa Jal might forgive something or Allah Azza wa Jal might not forgive. And so if he doesn't forgive, it stays there. Whatever is forgiven, then it's removed from the book. Right? And that's why Mondays and Thursdays are important. Important that we fast those days. Important that we do good deeds on those days. A lot of good deeds. Because actions are by its endings. So if you ended the 3 days in good, alhamdulillah, Allah has more chances that he will forgive the previous harm, wrong that we did. So as a result, ikhwani, that's why the Prophet said that I love to fast Mondays and Thursdays because my deeds are taken up to Allah on that day and I don't want my deeds to be presented to Allah except that I'm doing the best of deeds, which is fasting. طيب ووضي الكتاب فترى المجرمين مشفقين مما فيه ويقولون يا ويلتنا ما لهذا الكتاب لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها ووجدوا ما عملوا حاضرا. They found whatever they've done inside it. ولا يظلم ربك أحدا. Your Lord does not harm anybody. وإذ قلنا للملائكة. Remember when we said to the angels, اسجدوا لآدم. Prostrate to Adam. فسجدوا إلا إبليس. Everyone prostrated except for Iblis. كان من الجن. He was from the jinn. So there you go. Let not anyone ever think Iblis was ملائكة, because Allah says وكان من الجن. He is from the jinn. ففسق عن أمر ربي. So he went and transgressed against the command of his Lord. أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ Are you going to take him? وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ And his offsprings, which shows that Iblis does have children and offsprings. Are you going to take him and his offsprings, أَوْلِيَا As a helper, مِن دُونِ Except from me, meaning instead of me, you're going to take them as helpers? وَهُمْ لَكُمْ عَدُوْ Whilst they are your enemies. And what's wrong with you? You're going to take Iblis and his cronies and his offsprings as helpers for you rather than me. I'm the one who's your true helper. Other than Iblis, Iblis is your true enemy. You take him as your helper? What is wrong with you? أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءُ مِن دُونِي وَهُمْ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ Whilst he's an enemy, manifest enemy for you. بِئْسَ لِلظَّالِمِينَ بَدَلًا What a evil exchange is there for those who are ظالمين. Because the ظالمين are those who do evil. And they are the ones who have taken Iblis as their awliya. And what an evil change is there for the zalimeen. As for the righteous people, then alhamdulillah, Allah Azza wa Jal is the helper. وَمَا أَشْحَدْتُهُمْ خَلْقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ I have not shown them the creation of the heavens and the earth. وَلَا خَلْقَ أَنفُسِهِمْ And nor the creation of themselves. وَمَا كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذَ الْمُضِلِّينَ عَضُودًا Nor am I going to take these muttakhidin. I'm going to take the mudallin, those who have taken away, those who misguide others, aduda, as friends. وَيَوْمَ يَقُولُ نَادُ And when they will say, يَوْمَ يَقُولُ They will say, نَادُ شُرَكَاءَ الَّذِي زَعَمْتُمْ We will say to them, call upon your partners that you have thought or you have considered as partners with me. فَدَعَوْهُمْ So they called upon them. فَلَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَهُمْ No one will answer them. وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَوْبِقًا And we have put between them مَوْبِقًا Which is a compartment and a partition. Meaning, who is there? Where are those partners that you call? They will not even answer out of fear or these partners don't even exist. وَرَأَى الْمُجْرِمُونَ النَّارِ So when the wrongdoers have seen the fire, فَظَنُّوا And they knew أنهم معاقروها. When they saw it, they're like, oh my God, they can see their places in it. Some of the scholars said that وَظَنُّوا مُعَقِرُهَا, because they have seen their place in Jahannam. They recognized the fire. They know that they have a place there with their name on it. فَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ مُعَقِرُهَا, they know that they will enter it. وَلَمْ يَجِدُوا عَنْهَا مَصْرِفًا, and they did not find anything that will save them from it. What will they offer as in order to save them? They'll offer their children. Yeah, they will offer wealth. Can you imagine on that day, Allah says the mujrimeen will, yani if they could, they would offer their children, their wealth, whatever they had, whatever they could, they will offer in order to not enter into Jahannam. But nothing will be taken as a masrif, as a exchange for them, and they will be made to enter the fire. وَلَقَدْ صَرَّفْنَا فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ, indeed we have clarified in this Quran, لِلنَّاسِ, to mankind, مِنْ كُلِّ مَثَلٍ, and that's why this Quran is for all mankind, مِنْ كُلِّ مَثَلٍ, from every example. وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ أَكْثَرَ شَيْءٍ جَدَلًا, whereas mankind, he loves to argue about everything. Yeah, that's the mushkila. We are weak, we love to argue, and we are hasty, and that has landed humanity in so much problems and so much trouble. وَمَا مَنَعَ النَّاسَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا, and Allah has not forbidden mankind from believing. إِذْ جَاءَهُمُ الْهُدَى, when the guidance comes to them. وَيَسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّهُمْ, and he has not stopped them from seeking forgiveness from their Lord. إِلَّا أَن تَأْتِيَهُمْ سُنَّةُ الْأَوَّلِينَ, except that if they do that, meaning if they stop believing in Allah, or believing in the Huda, and stop making istighfar, then the sunnah of the awwaleen, of that which befell the people of the past, will also befall them. أَن يَأْتِيَهُمُ الْعَذَابُ قُبُلًا, or their adab will come to them in a hurried manner. وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, we have not sent the mursaleen, the messengers. إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْذِرِينَ, we have not sent them except give us a glad tidings to those who believe. وَمُنْذِرِينَ, and warners to those who disbelieve. وَيُجَادِلُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِالْبَاطِلِ لِيُضْحِضُوا بِهِ الْحَقِّ, and in order to debate those who have disbelieved in the truth, لِيُضْحِضُوا بِهِ الْحَقِّ, so that the truth may be established. وَاتَّخَذُوا آيَاتِي وَمَا أُنذِرُوا هُزُوًا, and they have taken my signs and what they have been warned with, هُزُوًا, meaning as a joke. They have taken my signs of what Allah has given, and also وَمَا أُنذِرُوا, and the people that have warned, and the warners themselves, as a mockery and a joke. وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ, who is the one who can be worse than this? Who is the one, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ, than the one who has been reminded with the signs of his Lord. فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا, then he turns away from it. وَنَسِيَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ يَدَاهُ, and he has forgotten what his hands have put forward. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ, we have put upon their hearts, akinnatan, akinna. Akinna is like a cover. Yeah, like a cover. Akinnatan, ay yafqahu, from which stops them from understanding. Wa fi adhanihim wa qara, and put a seal on their ears so they cannot even hear, nor can they actually even understand what they have been told. Wa in tad'uhum ila al-huda, if you were to call them to guidance, فَلَنْ يَحْتَدُوا إِذًا أَبَدًا, they will never ever be guided. وَرَبُّكَ الْغَفُورُ, and your Lord, on the other hand, your Lord, غفور, he is the merciful. ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, the possessor of mercy. He is the forgiving, إخواني, he is the possessor of mercy. ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, لَوْ يُؤَاخِذُهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا, if he were to take people to account for what they have done, لَعَجَّلَ لَهُمُ الْعَذَابِ, he would have definitely punished them. Because out of the justice of Allah, he has to punish them. But Allah is Ghafoor, he is Haleem, he is the Ghaffar, and as a result, because of his attributes of mercy and forgiving of forgiveness, he overlooks and he gives respite for a time. وَرَبُّكَ الْغَفُورُ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ لَوْ يُؤَخِذُهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا لَعَجَّلَ لَهُمُ الْعَذَابِ, if only Allah was not going to be Ghafoor and Haleem, if he was going to take people to account as soon as they did it, then he would not have left anyone on the face of this earth. بَلْ لَهُمْ مَوْعِدٌ, but rather they all have an appointed time. لَنْ يَجِدُوا مِنْ دُونِهِ مَوْئِلًا, and they will not find any escape from that مَوْعِد, that appointed time that they have been given. So when the appointed time comes, إخواني, end of story, that's it. There will be no escape from that. وَتِلْكَ الْقُرَى, and that is the town. أهلكناهم, we have destroyed them. لما ظلموا, when they had been wrong. لما ظلموا, when they had wronged themselves, that was the town that we had destroyed. وجعلنا لمهلكهم موعدا, and we had always set an appointed time for destroying them. So, Ikhwani, our town, Kuala Lumpur, or any other town that you live in, whichever town it is, if you want Allah Azawajal to not destroy it, then it is important that they come back to believing in Allah, believing in His signs, and making tawbah and istighfar. Otherwise, every single town out there has an appointed time. Whether it be in this dunya before the akhirah, meaning before the actual appointed time of destruction, but every single town out there, there is a time that Allah has set for it to be destroyed. Whether that be on the Day of Judgment, or whether it be before the Day of Judgment, just like, you know, Ad, Thamud, those towns, they had an appointed time. They were given respite until appointed time. So every single town out there, every single city out there has an appointed time attached to it. That if within that time people don't believe and fix themselves, then Allah's adab will definitely come down. Now Allah Azza wa Jal starts the story of Musa and Khidr. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ, and remember when Musa was sitting and the people asked Musa, Ya Musa, who's the most knowledgeable of all? So Musa alayhi salam, he said, I'm the most knowledgeable. And he didn't qualify that statement. So what happened was, Allah Azza wa Jal showed Musa a dream, or revealed to him, spoke to him, and said, oh Musa, no, you're not the most knowledgeable. There's actually another slave of mine that I blessed with more knowledge than you in some matters. So seek him out. So Musa, and just like a real student of knowledge, he wanted to seek knowledge, right? And so he left in search of that person. And that's why, Ikhwani, today knowledge comes to us. But that's why, you know, we become complacent. We should seek knowledge. We should go out and search for knowledge. Not just wait for someone to send me as a YouTube link or just watch stuff on YouTube. No, seek out knowledge. If you keep just seeking knowledge just from YouTube or from books, then your mistakes will increase because you've got no opportunity for interaction with your teacher. It's only through the questions that you ask, that you clarify, that you will really gain knowledge. Otherwise, you will never gain knowledge. So my brothers, my sisters in Islam, it's very, very important that you seek knowledge and you go out there and you learn. And you, if you know of someone more knowledgeable than you, then go to him and ask him for the knowledge that that person has. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى, remember when Musa said, لِفَتَى, to his servant boy, لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى, I am not going to rest, حَتَّى أَبْلُغْ, until I reach مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ, the joining of the seas, أَوْ أَمْدِيَ حُكُبًا, or I spend a long duration of time seeking it out, meaning I'm going to definitely go and seek knowledge. And Allah told him that he can find the Majma' al-Bahrain, and there he will find signs that will lead to Khidr. So he said, look, I'm going to find where the seas join together, or that I spend Hukub, which is a long duration of time. Hukub is like 1,000 years, as Al-Hasan al-Basri said. It's a way of statement, way of saying that I'm going to spend 1,000 years searching, which is a way of saying that, you know what, I'm going to keep on searching and never finish. Excuse me. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا, so when he reached the joining of the seas, نَسِيَ حُوتَهُمَا, he forgot that there was a hoot, which is a whale. So he forgot the whale that he was meant to follow at that point. فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ, so he took his path, فِي الْبَحْرِ سَرَبَ, so he kept on walking on the beach and on the path, being admiring the joining of the seas, and he forgot to wait for the whale who would lead him to his destination. فَلَمَّا جَاوَزُوا قَالَ لِفَتَاهُ آتِنَا غَدًا, so when he had passed that area, he told his servant, give us our lunch. لَقَدْ لَقِينَا مِن سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَبًا, I'm very, very tired, and really this travel has taken everything out of me. قَالَ أَرَأَيْتَ إِذْ أَوَيْنَا إِلَى الصَّخْرَةِ فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ, so they said, do you see, can we go back to the Sakhra, to that rock that we had? فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتِ, I have definitely forgotten the whale that I was meant to follow. وَمَا أَنْسَانِهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانِ, the second benefit was that nothing made me forget except the shaitan, because shaitan is going to try to take him off the path. So, and because he's seeking knowledge, which is an ibadah to Allah Azza wa Jal. So it is always shaitan who's going to try and distract me with wealth and with other distractions away from the knowledge and gaining the knowledge. وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا شَيْطَانٍ. Nothing made me forget except shaitan. أَنْ أَذْكُرَ from remembering this. وَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ عَجَبًا. And retook his path on the bahar, on the beach, عَجَبًا. Surprised, amazed at how shaitan could have fooled him. Yeah? And this is the second point of benefit, Ikhwani, is that when we are on a path to good deeds, gotta be really careful. Gotta be absolutely careful that we protect ourselves from the influence of the shaitan and from the shaitan coming and distracting us. قَالَ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنَّا نَبْقُ. He said, that is exactly what we intended. فَارْتَدَّ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمَا قَصَصًا. Then he went back upon his steps, following that back in order to find the path. فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا. But on that way, walhamdulillah, he found عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. He found a slave from our slaves. آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا. We gave him mercy from us. Meaning, what is mercy that is being referred to here? It is knowledge. So we gave him mercy from us. وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّ عِلْمًا. And we taught him from us special hidden knowledge that only we taught only a few people. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is talking about Khidr. Who is this man, Khidr? Khidr, according to many of the scholars of Islam, was a prophet of God. According to others, was not a prophet of God, was a righteous man. Allah Ta'ala alam, perhaps he was a prophet of God because he had knowledge that would come directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he did state that knowledge came directly from Allah. But either way, he was still lesser than Musa alayhi salam. Why? Because if he was a prophet, then Musa was a messenger, right? So a messenger was higher than a prophet. But that does not stop you from having sometimes more knowledge than even a messenger in a particular issue. And that's what we find in the Quran, especially in Surah Maryam and also in Surah Al-Imran, that Zakariya, whenever Zakariya went to Maryam was not a prophet of God, according to majority of the scholars of Islam, except for some scholars who believe that women can be prophets of God, but the vast majority believe that women cannot be prophets of God. So according to majority of the scholars of Islam, Maryam was not a prophet of God. So Zakariya would enter upon Maryam, and he was responsible for looking after the affairs of Maryam, would enter Maryam, would find lots of provisions and food. So whenever he found Maryam with food, he would say, "Anna laki hada," where is this from? He would say, she would say, "This is from Allah. Allah provides to whoever He wills without any account." So hunalika da'a Zakariya. Upon that, Zakariya called upon Allah Azza wa Jal. Meaning, Zakariya became inspired through the statement of Maryam, understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides who He wills. So all I have to do is really call upon Allah. At that point, Zakariya said, "Oh Allah, give me a righteous son, give me an offspring." So we know that therefore, even someone who is not a prophet of God can teach a prophet of God certain things. Yeah? And that's why, Ikhwani, everyone has to be humble. Gotta be humble. Gotta be absolutely humble, because you can gain knowledge from anybody. And that's why here Musa was humble, because he was being made to gain knowledge from someone who might have been lesser knowledgeable than him. And that's why Al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he said that statement. He said, "An alim does not become an alim until he gains knowledge from those higher than him, knowledge from those similar to him, and knowledge from those lesser than him." Meaning you have to gain and seek knowledge from everywhere, wherever they come from. Even if the knowledge comes from shaitan, you have to seek the knowledge. Yeah? And because shaitan did teach us, in the authentic hadith, shaitan did teach Muslims about the value of Ayatul Kursi, as in the authentic hadith when Abu Huraira was looking after the affairs of the Baytul Mal, and shaitan used to come as a thief. So at that point, on the third day, shaitan taught Abu Huraira the value of Ayatul Kursi, and that whoever recites Ayatul Kursi, shaitan will never stay. And so Rasulullah said, "Sadaqa wa huwa kadhub." He spoke the truth, but he is actually a liar. Meaning normally he is a liar, but he is a truthful in this case. So in this case, you can take what he said. So فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. So he found a slave from our slaves. آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا. We had given him wisdom from us. وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّ عِلْمًا. We had taught him the knowledge from us. قَالَ لَهُ مُوسَى. Musa said to him, هَلْ أَتَّبِعُكَ. Can I please follow you? عَلَىٰ أَن تُعَلِّمَنِ مِمَّا عُلِّمْتَ رُشْدًا. So that you can teach me from what you have been taught from Allah Azza wa Jal by way of guidance. قَالَ. He said, yes, you can. But لَن تَسْتَطِعْ مَعِي صَبْرًا. You can't be patient with it. Why? What do you mean I can't be patient? Of course I can be patient. No, you can't be patient. Why? because Allah taught me certain things which are very difficult for others to have sabr with. Yeah, certain things which are very difficult for others to have sabr with. And as you will see, Musa cannot have sabr with it because they really were difficult. And just to show you how Allah had taught him very fine things. قَالَ وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِدْ بِهِ خُبُرًا وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرْ How will you have sabr? عَلَى مَا Upon that which لَمْ تُحِدْ بِهِ You have not encompassed خُبُرًا in experience or knowledge. قَالَ سَتَجِدُنِي إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهُ صَابِرًا Don't worry. Inshallah, you will find me sabr. Yani, so Musa had made a firm resolve. I'm going to do my best to have sabr. Yeah. وَلَا أَعْصِي لَكَ أَمْرًا And I will not disobey you. قال, so therefore, he said, قَالَ فَإِنِ اتَّبَعْتَنِي So then if you follow me, فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي عَنْ شَيْءٍ Then don't ask me about anything. حَتَّى أُحْدِثَ لَكَ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا Until I explain to you about that issue, something or the other. Meaning have sabr until I tell you about it. And this is sometimes important because sometimes, you know, teachers, they want to explain in totality. Then they want you to ask questions because sometimes, you know, the first part can't be understood until you understand the last part. So sometimes teachers tell you that, listen, let me finish. Let me tell you everything. And then after that, you'll understand. And in reality, if Musa did that, perhaps he would have had more opportunity to understand. But obviously it's very difficult given the things that the Khidr is going to do. فانطلقا So they both went together. فَإِذَا حَتَّى إِذَا رَكِبَ فِي السَّفِينَةِ Until they both boarded a ship. فَخَرَقَهَا So what did Khidr do? Took his staff and he broke the ship and he made water come out so that some of the water started to fill up into the boat. قَالَ أَخَرَقْتَهَا Hey, what are you doing? Are you destroying the boat? أَخَرَقْتَهَا لِتُغْرِقَ أَهْلَهَا So that its people may be destroyed. And what's Musa doing? Musa's doing أَمَرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ نَهِي الْمُنْكَرْ He's commanding the good, forbidding the evil. But he's also forgotten that in the process of commanding good, forbidding the evil, he's also overlooked a promise that he made to Khidr that he wouldn't ask a question. قَالَ أَخْرَقْتَهَا لِتُغْرِقَ أَهْلَهَا Are you going to destroy the boat so that its people will be drowned? لَقَدْ جِئْتَ شَيْئًا إِمْرًا Man, you're doing a very, very wrong thing. If I was you, I would stop. You know, Allah's saying, you know, you're destroying. What are you doing? قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكَ إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَسْتَطِي مَعِيَ صَبْرًا Didn't I tell you you'll not be able to have sabr with me? So suddenly Musa realized, oh, okay. I was meant to have sabr over this? Oh, sorry about that, please. قَالَ لَا تُؤَخِذْنِي Please don't take me to account for this. بِمَا نَسِيتُ With what I have forgotten. وَلَا تُرْحِقْنِي مِنْ أَمْرِ عُسْرًا Nor create difficulty in this matter for me because I just forgot. Don't worry, it won't happen again. Please move on. فَانْطَلَقَا So they kept on moving. حَتَّى إِذَا لَقِيَ غُلَامًا Until they both met a boy, a young man. فَقَتَلَهُ So Khidr met the boy. The boy started walking back. Khidr turned back, took a knife and slit his throat. So what did Musa do? Musa obviously can't take this. This is killing a human soul. What do you do? قَالَ أَقَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا زَكِيَّةً Have you killed a zakiya nafs, yani an honorable soul here, بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ Without having any evidence that he had killed another human being, لَقَدْ جِئْتَ شَيْئًا نُكْرًا And this time, it's become imra to nukra, meaning even worse, you have done a very, very filthy thing. What an evil, filthy thing you've done. So what did he say? قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكَ إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَسْتَطِي مَعَيَ صَبْرًا Then I tell you, you cannot have sabr over this. قَالَ إِنْ سَأَلْتُكَ عَنْ شَيْءٍ بَعْدَهَا فَلَا تُصَاحِبْنِي He said, if you ask me about this again, then do not ever be with me any further. قَدْ بَلَغْتَ مِنْ لَدُنِّي عُذْرًا You have now, you know, reached the level of excuses. Three times, right? So you have reached the level, final excuse, you cannot give any more excuses. فَانْطَلَقَا So they both walked on. حَتَّى إِذَا أَتَيَا أَهْلَ قَرِيَةً Until they came to the people of a town, قرية استطاع ما أهلها أهل قرية استطاع ما أهلها فأبوا أن يضيفهما So they both asked, please can we stay with you for the night? But they both were like, nah, we don't have space for you, go away, you guys are strangers, get out of our town. فوجد فيها جدار So as they were coming out, they found near the wall of the city a piece of the wall that was very weak, it was about to fall. So what did he do? فَوَجَدَ فِيهَا جِدَارًا يُرِيدُ أَن يَنْقَضَّ the wall was wanting to fall off. فَأَقَامَ. So what did Khidr do? He pushed the wall, he fixed it. And so Musa said, you know what, these guys didn't let us stay. Why don't you have taken some money from them? At least we could have then given the money back to them, we could have stayed. So what did he say? قَالَ فَأَقَامَ قَالَ لَوْ شِئْتَ لَتَّخَثَ عَلَيْهَا جَرَى. If you wanted, you could have taken some, you know. And he thought that this would not be a sign of lack of sabr. He just offered advice. What did he say? لَوْ شِئْتَ لَتَّخَثَ عَلَيْهَا جَرَى. You know, when I read this, read the story of Musa and Khidr, I get this really deep desire to say, Ya Rabba, let me meet Musa one day. Because, you know, he's such an amazing guy. He couldn't hold his sabr. And for the love of God, he couldn't hold, you know, subhanAllah. لَوْ شِئْتَ لَتَّخَثَ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا. You know, it reminds me of my children, especially Ibrahim and Maryam. If I say, Ibrahim, Maryam, quiet. Shh. No, I'm on the phone. For the love of God, they can't keep quiet. For the love of God, even if there was a thief or a madman that had come into the house to kill and shoot everyone, a murderer that entered the house, for the love of God, they couldn't keep quiet. You know, so sometimes reminds me that, you know, I can understand very well Musa alayhi salam, because I can understand the curiosity that even our children have sometimes. قَالَ هَذَا فِرَاقُ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنِكَ. So what did he say? So Khidr lost sabr, and he said, قَالَ هَذَا فِرَاقُ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنِكَ. خَلَص, this is it. This is where you and I and our paths divide. سَأُنَبِّئُكَ بِتَأْوِيلِ مَا لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ عَلِيْهِ صَبْرًا. Now I'm going to tell you exactly the stuff that you could not have sabr over. Number one, فَأَمَّا السَّفِينَ. As for the safina, which is the boat, فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ. أَمَّا السَّفِينَةِ فَكَانَ لِمَسَاكِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ فِي الْبَحْرِ. As for the safina, that used to belong to the masakin, the poor people who used to work on the ocean, meaning they were fishermen. فَأَرَدْتُ أَنْ أَعِيبَهَا. And so I wanted to create some deficiency in that boat. وَكَانَ وَرَاءَهُمْ. And behind them was a malik, was a king. Some scholars said it could be a pirate. A pirate, يَأْخُذُ كُلَّ سَفِينَةٍ غَصْبًا, who used to take every single ship forcefully. So I didn't want the pirates or the king to take the ship forcefully, because if I created some problems with the ship, then they would say, okay, you know, it's already sinking, we don't want that one. Yeah. So better to have a partially deficient boat that needs to be fixed, rather than no boat at all. Yeah. So he understood the maslaha and mafsada. He understood the benefit and doubt, and that's what Musa somebody could not see. And this point is an evidence by brothers and sisters in Islam, that when you have ulama, when they give fatwa, that you cannot understand the reason for it. And I still remember it. This was in the Gulf War I, the first Gulf War, when many of the scholars allowed American soldiers onto Saudi soil and into the Balabal of the Haramain. They allowed them in order to defend Saudi Arabia from Saddam Hussein at that time. You know, many of the people say, what is this? This is misguidance, this is a sellout, this is cop-out, this is scholars for dollars, etc. But if you were to ask the ulama, then they had their maslah and mafsada. They understood. So I remember Sheikh bin Baz rahimullah, at that point, he gave the fatwa and he allowed that in. Why did he allow them in? For a number of reasons. Number one, because preserving the Bilad al-Haramain from war and battle is definitely important, because the Haramain, that is a place of sanctity and prayer, or Makkah Medina, sanctity and prayer for all people. If war had entered into that country, then Hajj might have to be cancelled. Then Ramadan might be in trouble. So Ikhwani, Ramadan in Makkah Medina may be in trouble. So to preserve that maslaha. Number two, the Prophet ﷺ was reported that when he was doing Hijrah, he sought the help of the disbelievers. The Dalil, which was the guide who took him away from the Quraysh and saved him, and showed him another direction and route towards Medina, was a non-Muslim guide. And so it is permissible, therefore, and he used many other evidences to show that it's permissible to do so. So they were looking at a different maslaha. And that's why whenever ulama give fatwa and ruling, have sabr, please. Respect the scholars. They may be seeing something that you're not seeing. So don't be in a rush or a judgment to give an apparent ruling which any Tom, Dick and Harry with half a brain can understand. But if the scholars are doing something which openly seems to be wrong, then have sabr, and until you're able to ask them, saying, Shaykh, what is the problem? And this is also a benefit of the doubt we have to give to rulers today. Because rulers have so many issues that are upon them. We must give them benefit of the doubt. We must give them, as the hadith states, though it's not authentic, but the meaning is true. Give your brother 70 excuses. Give your brother 70 excuses before you consider them to be wrong. So, Ikhwani, this is an important lesson for us. أَمَّا السَّفِينَ فَكَانَتْ لِمَسَاكِنَ يَعْمَلُونَ فِي الْبَحْرِ فَرَدْتُ عَنْ عَيْبَهَا وَكَانَ وَرَاءَهُمْ مَلِكٌ يَأْخُذُ كُلَّ سَفِينَ غَصْبًا وَأَمَّا الْغُلَامُ As for the young man that I killed, فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ Then his two parents were righteous people. فَخَشِينَ أَنْ يُرْهِقَهُمَ الطُّغْيَانَ وَكُفْرًا And we were afraid that this young man would approach the parents with nothing but tughyan, meaning disobedience and haughtiness and evil, wa kufra, and overlooking the goodness that the parents have done. Meaning, though the parents were righteous, mu'minin, but the son was a very bad human being. So the judgment at that time in the Sharia of Muhammad, Sharia of Musa al-Salam at that time, was any aqbul waliday could be killed. Yeah. Aqli waliday, and also in the Sharia of Khidr, the aqli waliday, the one who was bad to your parents, can be killed. In fact, there is a statement that has also been reported from Isa alayhi salam, that the aqli waliday should not be allowed to live. The one who is bad to his parents, beats his parents, swears at his parents, then that person should not be allowed to live. This was in their time, okay, in the Sharia of the past, this was considered a sin that was worthy of being killed over. Just to show you how serious this punishment is. So Ammal Ghulam, then his parents were righteous people, and I was afraid that he would be bad to them, so therefore, فَأَرَدْنَا أَيُّبْدِلَهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُ So أَرَدْنَا أَيُّبْدِلَهُمَا So I, under the command of Allah Azza wa Jal, wanted to change the son, so that if we kill the son off, Allah would change this son and give them another righteous son. خَيْرًا مِّنْهُ زَكَاتًا وَأَقْرَبَ رُحْمًا Allah would give them another merciful son instead and in place of this son, if this son was no longer there. And so that's why I killed him. So this is the reason why Khidr killed him. وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارِ As for the brick wall, فَكَانَ الْغُلَامَيْنِ used to belong to two orphans in the city. And this shows you, therefore, Ikhwani, many a times when you don't understand context, you can't understand the actions. If you don't understand context, you can't understand action. And that's why when you don't understand context, avoid giving a ruling. Yeah, avoid giving a ruling. Oh, I saw someone do this. Avoid giving a ruling. You don't know the context. Oh, but I saw that person prostrating to an idol. You don't know the context. Go and ask before you call him shaitan, kafir, evil, non-Muslim, etc. Whatever you want to call him, go and judge the person. So say, Akhi, did you know there was an idol there in front of you? What idol? I'm blind. Don't you know I'm blind? So you were just about to make the blind Muslim into a kafir. He was blind. He didn't know. He was just praying his dhuhr prayer. Or a person could be saying, oh yeah, I knew the idol, but you know, I had some really bad food, you know, and I'm like, ah, went like that. And he just bounced over, you know. I'm just making up stories. But the point I'm trying to make is never pass judgment without knowing context. Know the context, then pass judgment. Okay? It's very important. So, Ammal Jidar, as for the wall, used to belong to two orphans, yatimain, in the city. وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا And underneath that wall was their treasure. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا This bit is very important. And their father was a righteous man. And because the father was a righteous man, فَأْتَعْقِيمِ Meaning, because of that, أَرَادَ رَبُّكَ Your Lord wanted أَن يَبْلُغَ أَشُدَّهُمَا That they should both reach their puberty. وَيَسْتَخْرِجَ كَنْزَهُمَا And then Allah will bring their treasure out. رَحْمَةً مِنْ رَبِّكَ As a mercy from Allah. So therefore, Ikhwani, this verse is an evidence that Allah wanted good. As Ibn Abbas said, about the tafsir of this verse, he said, Allah wanted good for the orphans لِصَلَاحِ أَبِيهِمَا Because of the righteousness of their father. And that's why, my brothers, my sisters in Islam, if you want good for your children, you have to be good. Just like these two orphans, the father was good, and as a result, Allah wanted good for them. If you are not good, then Allah will not want good for your children at all. If you don't pray, don't fast, don't give sadaqah, if you don't stay away from sins yourself, then Allah will misguide your children. And that's why Allah guided the children of Ibrahim, because Ibrahim was so righteous. And that's why, Ikhwani, we want our children to be righteous. If I want my 7 children, alhamdulillah, to be guided, I have to be a more righteous person. I have to pray more, fast more, give more zakat, stay away from more evil. Otherwise, Allah will misguide my kids. And Ikhwani, my brothers and sisters, this is the true way to guide your children. You should become righteous. And that's why Sa'id al-Musayyib, one of the great scholars of the past, he used to look at his son and he used to say, "Oh my son, la azidanna min salati min ajlik. I'm going to pray more because of you." Why? Because if I pray more, then Allah will be more kind and look after you. And that's the real way to save your children on the Day of Judgment. طيب. وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي. I have not done this of my own account. I've done this because Allah has asked me to do so. ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ مَا لَمْ تَسْطِعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. And that is the explanation of what you could not have sabr over. So, lessons from the story of Musa and Khidr. Number one, always humble yourself. Remember, however much knowledge you have, there's someone who knows more than you. Number two, context. Always understand context. Without context, you will never be able to understand the issue. If you don't know context, keep quiet. If you don't know the full context, keep quiet. And that's very, very critical. Number three, and that is to have sabr with the opinions of the scholars. And when ulama and when rulers have given a judgment and an opinion, when you don't understand it, have sabr. Oh, why are you telling taxes? Taxes are haram, I can't pay taxes. Have sabr. There may be a reason why they have done this, okay? Oh, why are they doing this judgment, this ruling, this, you know, have sabr. Yeah, ask them. If you cannot, then have sabr. And give your brother 70 excuses, whether it be rulers of any country or whether it be Muslim ulama or du'at. Have sabr with them and wait till you go and ask them, inshallah, okay? Don't be the people who judged. Don't judge too quickly. Don't judge just on face value, yeah? Always judge after knowing the full story, because it may be, subhanAllah. I mean, can you imagine, if you were there, I'm sure Musa would be thinking that, you know, if I was Khidr and I knew that this safina belonged to the poor people and behind the safina was this pirate, evil pirate who was going to take the ship away, I would have also destroyed a portion of the ship or done something or the other to make the pirate not take the ship, right? So, subhanAllah, yani, if you sometimes think about it, the context opens up the doors for you. Number four is to make tawbah to Allah and seek refuge in Allah for all the times that you pass judgment in haste and that you are hasty in passing judgments. Make tawbah to Allah, because it may be that you actually misunderstood. You thought you're right, but you're actually wrong. Number five is to learn the lesson of having sabr with your mashayikh, and being and having that sabr is very, very critical. Because having that sabr is very, very important. Otherwise, sometimes you lose the benefit of the mashayikh. And sometimes, I know myself, for example, when I'm teaching, when I'm interrupted and I'm not given the opportunity to finish what I'm saying, sometimes I lose the barakah and benefit. And as a result, it's very important to give mashayikh the space and the time. Another point of benefit I wanted to point out was that some people might use this story of Musa and Khidr and say, okay, you know, my sheikh knows. My sheikh's got, you know, hidden knowledge. There's something called hidden knowledge. No, there's nothing called hidden knowledge. He says that this is a knowledge which Allah had taught him, and he had done it. وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي. Meaning, I didn't do it out of myself. I did it because Allah taught me that. So, when you say your sheikh has hidden knowledge, what evidence do you have that your sheikh is mulham, that he has been inspired by God, that he has hidden knowledge? You don't have any evidence for that. If there was, then even Abu Bakr and Umar would behave like this. But none of them has ever been reported that they behave like this, which showed that this is special knowledge that is from Allah, that is given to prophets of God, and you have no right to call your sheikh a prophet. If you do this, that is disbelief. And if he doesn't have knowledge from Allah, then what secret knowledge does he have? So don't use this. You know, people use this like, okay, my sheikh has secret knowledge. He doesn't have secret knowledge. He may just have some other knowledge, but knowledge from Allah Azza wa Jal, you have no evidence that your sheikh has that secret knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali and others were more worthy of having secret knowledge. So don't be of those people who say that you guys are scholars, the apparent knowledge, and my sheikh is a sheikh of the secret knowledge. Don't be like that. That is misguidance, Ikhwani. And the last point of benefit, Ikhwani, Last point of benefit is to ask for clarification. As Khidr over here offered his clarification so that Musa does not think that he's an evil man and that he does things out of his own desire, it's always important to clarify. And that's why Rasulullah, once he was with his wife, Safiya, it was dark, and then two people walked past, and then they saw Rasulullah with a woman. They started walking faster. And the Prophet said, hold on, guys, this is, I am Rasulullah, and this is Safiya, my wife. So the people said, no, Ya Rasulullah, we never had doubts. We never thought that there would be any wrongdoing here. So the Prophet said, yes, you're right. But Shaitan flows in the veins of Adam like the flowing of blood. Meaning, Shaitan comes and he whispers and he gives you doubts. So like, oh man, I saw that man with that wife. What's going on? Oh, astaghfirullah. He must be flirting around with other girls. We should tell his wife. Next thing you know, that's his sister. Next thing you know, that's his sister that he has never seen from America that came. And you don't even know. You know what I'm trying to say? So it's very important that you establish the truth. And that's why if there is a possibility that you are misunderstood by people, always make sure, brothers and sisters, you clarify to others and you tell them. So hold your horses, guys. This is my wife, or this is my sister. Hold your horses before you misunderstand, guys. This issue, the real explanation is this. Make your side of the story well known, inshallah. That is something very, very important to do, inshallah. Zakumullah khair. We are at the end. I hope, inshallah ta'ala, what we've taken from the story of Musa and Khidr has been beneficial. I always benefit from it. And alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a chance to meet Khidr and Musa one day in Jannah. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Tomorrow, inshallah, will be the story of Dhul Qarnayn, inshallah. And with that, alhamdulillah, the story of Dhul Qarnayn, we will come to the end of Surah Kahf, and we will finish there, after which, inshallah, we will start with Surah Maryam, inshallah, with stories of many of the prophets of God there, inshallah, coming up. Jazakallah khair. Until tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.